everybody. Happy Monday and welcome to Collider TV Talk, TV Talk for TV fans. I'm your host, Sinead DeFries, and this is the weekly show where we bring you the latest news from the world of television, plus talk about the week that was in TV. Joining us this afternoon is Josh McCouga.
Thank you, Sinead. Well, Sinead is the consummate professional, but I would like to break this news that we are pre-taping this in honor of Martin Luther King Jr. Our offices are closed, and thus we are not shooting on Monday. Therefore, we will not be talking about Lemony Snicket's. We did not get a chance to watch it yet on Netflix. We will, however, be talking about Taboo, The Young Pope, because we got a screener, and all kinds of other stuff, as well as taking just as many Twitter questions as humanly possible the entire second half of the show. All Twitter questions. Who else is here?
Also here is Sacha Pearl Raver.
I feel like you just used the wrong title for The Young Pope. I like calling it what Patton Oswalt calls it, which is gotta get that Pope's D all up in me, which is a much better title for the show. And I'm very happy to be here. Happy MLK Day.
Also here is David Griffin.
What?
I didn't say it, Patton Oswalt did.
I am back in my original seat. No more Dave Cam, but thank you for to Adam and Cody for setting up the Griff Cam. The Griff Cam was so nice. It was nice to be over there on the couch. Silent for 30 minutes.
We should have called it the Isle of Griff.
It was the Isle of Griff.
It was the Isle of Griff. Yeah. Like
I'm glad
that.
To be back. Oh, and also we should say too, we are pre-taping, as Josh said, but so Sherlock season four finale. We'll get back to that.
Talk about that on January 23rd.
We're going to be watching it for sure.
That's my birthday.
Happy birthday. We're going to do something special for the Tan's birthday.
I know it's on a Monday. Are you guys excited?
Oh, really? Yeah. Nice.
We're going to put 10 candles on your cake.
On 10 cakes.
On 10 cakes. Donuts.
On 10 donuts. Oh, and then nice. I'm going to eat all of them and be like, second Sinead, sorry, it's a rhythm.
So you know how there's a baker's dozen at 13? There's a Sinead dozen at 10.
Perfect.
Yay. 10.
There's a donut behind Sinead.
Oh, yes. That's.
Oh, my God, you guys. Uh-huh. I can't wait.
Okay. So we're going to break down a bunch of stories here off the top, do some pilot reviews. And then, again, second half of the episode is going to be all Twitter questions. You guys have been asking us to do this, and I thought it was more than time to do it, I guess, since we are pre-taping and it is holiday time for Martin Luther King Jr. So, Sinead, let's break down these first bunch of stories.
All right, so American Horror Story has been renewed for 3 more seasons. Donald Glover announced that he has to delay Atlanta because of the Yang Han movie. Fargo 3.0 has begun production, so we'll see a premiere in April. Peaky Blinders has confirmed that Tom Hardy is returning, and Stephen Knight says it will be the best season yet. The Defenders Entertainment Weekly spread just dropped, and Blackish Election Day episode.
Well, I mean, I think American Horror Story getting rid of it is kind of a duh. I mean, that like everybody just keeps loving on that show. They keep. Mm-hmm. I personally don't watch it, and everybody knows why. Donald Glover, that makes sense. Fargo 3.0. I'm kind of shocked. I thought they would. Beginning production now and seeing it in April, it kind of makes me think they got the writing right, and they're like, we can rush production a little bit. So because if they're comfortable with the writing. They want to see it sooner than later.
It also sounds to me like probably they have a heart out on Tom Hardy. So they were like, we're going to get him. He's going to be in it. We're shooting it right away. And it'll be done by April because we have to shoot it before he goes on to his next movie.
Right. Yeah. Totally makes sense.
Yeah.
Peaky Blinders. Anything Peaky Blinders I get excited about, obviously.
But with the Donald Glover news, by the way, I'm okay. People were tweeting at us about like, oh God, till 2008. That's okay, you guys. It's fine. Let's just rewatch the 10 episodes we had. But how about the fact that FX signed him to an overall deal? That's very smart.
Yes.
And one of the things that it seemed like they were sort of pushing were streaming services and online platforms, because FX has FX Now, but there's not a lot that doesn't exist on the channel. Mm-hmm. I feel like that is a partnership that will serve them very well. I hope he becomes the Shonda Rhimes of FX.
Well, John Lindgren seems like he's, as a president, probably maybe the best president of any network, at least to interview. It seems like he's the most aware of what's happening in the TV landscape. And talking to Allison here last week, she was saying that they love interviewing him because he's just so involved in the TV world. He loves studying it. He loves the culture of it and how it's changing, how there's like 500 new dramas that are going to be coming out in the next year. Like, he loves all this stuff. So I'm glad that he's leading the way for FX. He's a great president.
Did either of you guys watch The Comedians, the Josh Gad, Billy Crystal show that was on FX?
I missed that.
I watched like the first three episodes.
I remember it only lasted one season. Then it was.
Yeah, it kind of like disappeared.
Do you guys
right?
remember Dennis O'Hare on the show?
I don't think so.
Basically, he was playing John Landgraf, which I think is really funny. Yeah. And if you rewatch the show, you're like, oh, he's really good at his job, but he's also sort of a tyrant.
Yeah.
I've never met him. I don't know. He's paying his bills, but I don't know anything about him.
Like,
but he seems great.
I was gonna say too, just get to back to Stephen Knight. I like that he's bouncing between film and television. Like, he did Allied, which I think was a very underrated film with Marion Cotillard and Brad Pitt. I actually really enjoyed that. And then he's done Peaky Blinders, of course, Taboo. He kind of goes back and forth. I like that he's got that variety. He's not afraid to do, you know, go back and forth between film and television.
Speaking of not being afraid, though, I am wearing my Oaklandish
What is that?
Shirt today? Because you're not just from Oakland, you Oaklandish.
This could be a weird time for Oakland people too, because the Chargers came to LA and the Raiders could go to Vegas sooner than later.
I don't care about any of that stuff. Yeah. But what I do care about is Black-ish. So I have said for a while that my one hope for our incoming presidency is that it will breed great new art. And last night's episode of Black-ish, last night being 4 days ago when this actually airs, was that. It was so brilliant. The commentary, the humor, the way it handled a very difficult topic. Anthony Anderson's monologue was stunning. Everything they gave Tracee Ellis Ross to do was incredible. That was one of the best episodes of television, especially a comedy show, and so brave. Like, Norman Lear must be standing up right now just cheering, because that was off the charts.
Mm. Oh, I have to watch it.
So good. Kenny Barris.
Somebody tweeted at me the monologue of Anthony Anderson in the boardroom. I haven't gotten to the full episode. I'm usually like, with Black-ish, I'm usually like three episodes behind, and then I go binge like four in a row.
Yeah.
And I haven't gotten to last night's yet. But I don't usually talk about politics at all, but I do appreciate the fact that a show, deservedly so, and I think that's the right show to go there, because they always tackle current issues really well. I think they did the Ferguson riots and a lot of the police shooting stuff really well. And I think that, you know, a lot of these other shows are so farcical in nature. I mean, they make me laugh all the time, but they're not the right show to tackle something like this. And I think Black-ish is the one to do it, mostly because Anthony Anderson kind of flipped the tables on what a black, quote-unquote, comedy should be. And that's why, I continue to watch it.
I don't watch it.
You should watch that.
I don't mean to sound vindictive. I just don't watch it. Another don't like it. I just don't watch it.
Yeah.
The writing last night, I mean, God, it's just so smart. It's so smart and so brave. Mm. So good. Thank you guys. That was an amazing.
I'm glad to hear what you said about it being a show that is not afraid to challenge what a black show is. I think I steer away from some of those shows when I do see them coming out, because I'm like, okay, here we go. Here's another family. It's always kind of, but I heard this is good, so I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah. You should watch the episode they did about the N-word. Oh my God, it's so good. Also, the episode they did about having the flu. It's good.
Because I just had it, and it's not that fun.
It's just a great show. It's brilliant.
What else is up there, Sinead? Well, we didn't talk about the EW, the Defender spread. Although it was a cool little behind-the-scenes video.
Yeah, it's all style, action shots, do it, you know.
Yeah, but I just get more and more excited about this. Obviously, we haven't seen Iron Fist yet. And he's that fourth one they throw in there.
There's a shot in the EW where he's like, it's like he's kind of showing off his nipple. Like, he's doing like this.
I'm telling you.
I think he's trying to show off the tattoo, but it's like a nipple
I
shot.
I know. He
and
is.
I'm like, that's Loras Tyrell. That's Loras Tyrell.
He
Game of Thrones.
Really? He's the big question mark.
So. That's because they're rock hard.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not hating. I mean, it looks good.
Are they
good,
hard right now?
Just,
move your hands.
No, I have a sweatshirt on.
He's got two layers on.
He's warm. Josh is warm right now. He's toasty.
Look at the other layer. Let's see. Sorry, Mrs. Griffin.
Yeah, I mean, I just think it's cool that we're seeing them all together, at least in a photo shoot for the most part. But, you know, I mean, the crazy part is, for a pre-taped week and for what Monday is coming and the TCA is going on, we could have done a four-hour TV talk.
Yeah.
We
yeah.
legitimately
By the time
so
Monday
much to
hits,
do.
There's going to be so much
I know.
More.
Why don't you guys talk about this? I'm like, what's the show? God damn it. All right, what's next, Sinead?
Joel and Ethan Coen, the brothers behind such films like No Country for Old Men and True Grit, are taking their love of Westerns and bringing The Ballad of Buster Scruggs to TV. There is no word on plot, but it is said to involve six different storylines in a Western motif and could possibly see a theatrical release of a portion of the show. Sasha, is a Western what you'd want the Coen brothers to do for their first foray into television?
Hi, you guys. I'm so sorry, you guys. So, guys. True Grit, one of the greatest Westerns in recent memory, also one of the best dark comedies, because what the Coen brothers do so brilliantly is like pitch black comedy. This is going to be the business. I cannot wait. What's so exciting is, all right, so it's going to be on Showtime. They said it's only going to be six episodes. I am praying to all of the heavens above that the episodes are not 60 minutes, but they are 90 or 120.
Wait, is that confirmed?
Yeah. So it's going to be six episodes, interwoven stories. But what the Coens have said in the past is, they weren't interested in television because they felt like investigating a character for 2 hours was enough time to really tell a story. So with this, what I'm hoping is they're basically making 6 movies and they will weave them together in some very interesting ways. I can't wait to see who they end up casting. They are brilliant beyond belief. This is phenomenal. I just hope the episodes are longer than 60 minutes. That's my one hope and prayer.
I gotta say, I'm a little pissed.
What?
I'm so over Westerns. We got Westworld. Ugh. We got...
Speak up for yourself.
Here's the thing. Listen, I love True Grit. I love the original True Grit. And I love...
Deadwood?
Deadwood, yeah. No problem. But Deadwood was 8 years ago, 9 years ago.
Time for another good one.
What we need is the Coen brothers to go... Like, when they said The Ballad of Buster Scruggs, I was like, please be something like dark comedy. Like, this guy is some kind of, like, jazz musician in the 60s. Or, like, he's a bluegrass musician that's, also a criminal. And it could be fun.
How do you know that that's not going to happen? It just might not be in the 60s. Or it might be. We don't know.
Like, a modern-day Western. Music. I don't know. I'm just so tired of friggin' Westerns. Like, everybody...
You act like there's so many Westerns.
Right?
No, it's just, like, I was so exhausted by Westworld that...
It's just Westworld that's bothering you. That's it.
That's
it's not Westerns.
Like,
it's just Westworld.
That's literally what it comes down to.
That's all. Just Westworld.
Westworld, which is fantastic.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Westworld, which is about the most average TV can get.
Wow.
So good.
Wow. Shots fired. Blah, blah, boom, clat. Yeah. What? Yeah. What? 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 Did you just say average?
Yes.
What?
Yeah, go ahead.
Sasha's out.
Walk away. Walk away.
It is a good thing it is MLK Day, and I believe in peace today. Woo.
Yeah, no.
Very.
The table is moving. I got stuff real today. No, I want the Coen brothers to do a Lebowski-esque show on HBO that is 60 minutes, 6 episodes, rock hard, gimme a throner type of television. I don't want another.
So you
I don't want another Western.
My line
like,
while talking smack.
Yes, yes. I don't want the Coen. I don't want a Western being like, hey, old school. No.
That wasn't how No Country for Old Men was.
I don't think anybody wants that.
No Country for Old Men is a modern
day
Western, and it's not even a Western.
But you don't even, yes it is.
It's
and
not
you don't
a
even
Western.
Know what this is going to be.
It's about the Mexican drug trade and the man with a cattle prod. That is not a modern day Western. Or that's not a Western. That is, it's, here, listen, Hell or High Water.
That's a modern day Western.
Sure, give me something the Coen brothers
how do you know
like
that. That won't be this. It could be Hell or High Water, but with more comedy.
No Country for Old Men is it's Cormac McCarthy, which is close enough to a Western. He does. Cormac McCarthy loves the destruction of the Southwest.
Okay.
That's what all his books are about. Okay, I think this is going to be great because I haven't had a chance to speak on this. But Sasha, I'm looking around. I still don't think it's confirmed yet about Showtime. They're still shopping it. Yeah, there's obviously going to be competitors, Amazon, Showtime. I think it's going to be between HBO, Amazon, and Netflix. I think those are going to be the three because they want to do part of it as a film too. So they haven't decided yet where they want to go. I really am rooting for, as much as I love Netflix and Amazon, I'm rooting for HBO. I want to see this released on a weekly basis. I'd love to just have 1 week with the Coen brothers and be like, we have another week of the Coen brothers. We have 5 weeks of the Coen brothers. I want to see it. So I'm rooting for HBO to get this project whenever they decide on it.
I like that. Very much, Griffin. And thank you for correcting me on where it's going
to
end
up. I just
up.
Wanted to make sure, because I remember reading earlier, and I was just wanting to make sure. But that's a good question. Like, where is it going to go?
I thought it was Showtime, but I'm
probably where's it going to go?
Who knows?
Shade, what's next?
I love you guys so much.
We love you,
Sinead. Oh. All right, Showtime president David Nevins treated Twin Peaks fans with some great news at the TCAs when he announced that the series will debut on May 21st of this year and will be a one-time event with 18 total hours of programming. David, what would you like to see from the Twin Peaks series?
I'm really not familiar with the Twin Peaks series, even though I've heard, because I'm an X-Files fan, that I should watch it.
Yeah.
I think that might have been a little before. I've been pretty young when that came
should
out.
Should we try and, like, maybe watch it? Like, well, obviously not together, but I'm
we
saying,
should.
Like, watch
yeah,
it
you can stream it.
To,
yeah,
you watch
we should definitely
Peaks
watch it.
Yeah,
from
but I
want to
rewatch it because I haven't seen it in,
so
like, a
long.
Decade and a half.
And probably. Also, too, you see that picture that we put up there of David Lynch that's also behind Sinead so perfectly with the donut in his mouth. He did that when he did the screeners for the president and one of the other big heads at Showtime. He actually gave them a donut before every episode that he showed. So that was kind of, rather than on Deadline, I believe.
Yeah,
that was interesting. It looks good. So he shot it as one big movie.
Yeah.
And they weren't really sure how they're going to divide up the episodes, but they decided on 18 hours, I guess, and cut it up in an hour-long program.
The first couple weeks are like two hours.
Right, exactly. So
and then,
that's a lot of content. But, I mean, they're praising it. It's fantastic. We're going to talk about a show later on that we saw a trailer of. They're hoping that Twin Peaks will kind of help bolster that audience for that. So, I mean, I'm excited about this.
And, I remember as a kid watching the first few episodes of Twin Peaks and being really scared because I was a scared kid. I'm a scared adult, to be honest with you. I don't like horror movies or anything like that. But There's something about this going to Showtime that really excites me because I haven't really disliked much that Showtime has done recently. Like, I'm even on the Billions train. Do you know what I mean?
What about that music show we watched? What was that? About the band with Luke Wilson?
Oh, groupies. Wait, roadies.
Roadies.
That wasn't
on Showtime.
That wasn't on Showtime. That snuck backstage and got on Showtime somehow, and they ripped it. They were like, whoa, whoa, whoa. It was kind
of
like,
who put this on the air? And then everyone was like, Cameron Crowe.
Yeah. I'm going to go back and I'm definitely going to go back and watch Twin Peaks because I think we need a refresher because it's been, 20 plus years to see what, because David Lynch, I mean, come on, guy's a madman and I love it. He's my kind of dude. I want to smoke cigarettes and drink bourbon with that dude.
I believe it's been 29 years. Sinead, can you fact check me on that? Mm-hmm. But in the same Deadline article where the president talked about them getting donuts before each episode, which I love so much, they also quoted him as saying, this is, quote, pure heroin David Lynch.
Yes.
I mean,
I don't even know what that means.
What more could you
ask? Blue Velvet.
Oh, yeah. I think this is going to be phenomenal. And in a situation where so rarely do I get excited about somebody being like, there's going to be 18 episodes, this, I'm like, all right, 18, good. And they've said very much like, this is expected to be a standalone. Like, this isn't supposed to go on for seasons and seasons and seasons. But after wanting this for so many years, so many fans begging for this, finally it happening. Wait, maybe it's 19 years.
No,
it's 1998, right?
It ran until 91.
91.
And then there was a movie in 92.
Oh yeah, so I was like 7 years
two
old.
So old, and I'm so bad at math.
And so I was again. Yeah, I remember being scared. So I was 9.
It was ABC.
What happened to it? Because it says it premiered in April of 1990 and ran until June of 1991.
Yeah.
So it was sort of like a cult phenomenon at the time, but it didn't get huge numbers. And then what David Lynch says, where he was like, oh, it's fine. We're gonna give you a spinoff so you can like know what happened. And then the spinoff was a prequel. So
it's just like, really messed with you.
Also called Twin Peaks.
I'm sorry?
Also called Twin Peaks?
Yeah. It was called Twin Peaks Firewalk with Me.
Yeah, yeah. So it's still in like the same family and the same thing, but yeah. In a classic David Lynch like switcheroo, like, remember when I said it was gone?
Never mind.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
Let's talk some trailers. Showtime released a trailer for their upcoming series, I'm Dying Up Here, which is loosely based on the book of the same title and chronicles the early days of stand-up comedy in the 1970s Los Angeles. We were also treated to a promo video for AMC's Better Call Saul that was actually just a fake commercial for everyone's favorite meth-flavored fried chicken chain, Los Pollos Hermanos. Josh, what do you think Los Pollos Hermanos tastes like?
I always, I mean, it's got to have that little meth twang to it.
With curly fries.
What an interesting question.
You don't like them, they're free. Yeah,
that's right.
Who would ask such a question? Whenever watching Breaking Bad and Los Pollos Hermanos, I always got that sick feeling in my stomach from El Pollo Loco. Oh, God, I hope they don't sponsor this channel at all because I've never had a good experience at that place.
El Pollo Loco?
Yeah.
Oh, you're crazy.
El Pollo Loco is
the bomb. Really? Oh, it's all about, they had this bowl back in the day that was so good, that avocado salsa.
Am I just ordering the wrong thing there?
I think it's a little overpriced.
I think Taco Bell's good, though, so my standards are very low.
But you won't eat turkey
because of like the gobbling and the vagina neck?
No, turkeys are disgusting. There's a difference. There's a difference. They gobble. Your food should not gobble.
Well, what should it do?
I'm with Sinead. It should bark. Bark, bark.
Yeah.
Wow.
Also kind of gross, but not as gross as turkey.
So great trailer, though. Oh, yeah. Great teaser. Yeah,
I loved this. I loved this fake commercial because we haven't seen Gus Fring yet in Better Call Saul, which I'm hoping is a teaser to us really getting introduced into when, you know, Slippy Jimmy, what do they call him? Slippin' Jimmy?
Slippin' Jimmy, I think so.
When he turns into, you know, Saul Goodman.
Well, Giancarlo Esposito was still one of my favorite things about Breaking Bad. I thought he was the best villain, I mean, besides, of course, Walter White, but I thought he was just so good. I mean, even when he's just slick.
And also the best exit for a character.
Best exit.
Ever.
Always looking good, always looking sharp, yeah.
But I think we need to talk about I'm Dying Up Here.
Yeah, oh, 100%.
So my fear, as soon as
I saw it. Have you ever read the book?
I did not read the book. I know that Jim Carrey is behind it. That made me excited. Yeah. And then I watched the trailer this afternoon.
And Bucky's in there. The Winter Soldier.
Jim Carrey's not really in the book.
Okay.
I read the book a long time ago, based on when I first moved to LA, and I was doing way more stand-up. It chronicles guys like Richard Lewis, Elaine Boozler, there's a guy still touring today. I forget his name. He's an old guy. But it talks about their early days and everything going on at the Comedy Store, from like the Coke riddle to like the the shows to it being a strip club, also a comedy club, a lot of Mitzi Shores, a lot of getting past the actually them getting paid and getting on the Tonight Show and how cutthroat it was, but how they were all friends. And it's a really, really interesting book if you like stand-up comedy. This trailer, however...
It looks like vinyl. It looks like vinyl. And I can't tell if it's the vinyl that I wanted vinyl to be or the vinyl ended up being, and I fear it is the latter. And I love the dude who's on Girls, who was also in Obvious Child, Jake, he's awesome. He's the one who plays like the stand-up who is succeeding and is doing like late-night shows. Mm-hmm. I love him.
My buddy Andrew Santino plays the redhead with the beard.
I am very concerned.
The 70s hair, they're all...
Wigs.
I'm really here, right? Because... It's really hard to do a show about stand-up comedy without using the proper names. Like, you'd want to get their thing, and you'd want to get the true stories from all these people. That's why a lot of it has been changed. Even though they kept the title from the book, they changed all the names, they changed all the jokes. But they kept similar storylines the same.
This is the thing, and this is the problem I had with vinyl. Have you ever been the DD, the designated driver, at a party where everyone is just hammered and everyone's having like the best time and you're watching it?
It's the worst.
That's how I feel watching this show, watching vinyl. It's like, oh, you guys are having
Michael Onganaro.
No, Michael Onganaro was a little kid from Almost Famous.
Oh, okay.
That's how I feel watching the show. It's like they're partying and raging. And the fact that Melissa Leo is in it, I adore her. I think she's a phenomenal actress.
She's playing Mitzi Shore, basically.
It's just here.
You and Sebastian Stan.
Sebastian Stan.
Bucky.
He's playing, he's
Jake
playing.
Lacey.
Oh, Jake Lacey.
Jake Lacey. I like him.
Okay.
I liked it in him.
but go on. Make your point.
No, that's what it feels like watching the trailer. It's like they're raging. They're weeping. I did not care about any of the characters in the intros. And it just felt very, very poorly staged.
Try being pregnant. Sucks.
What? That was the weirdest.
Everybody's raging and having a great time. And you're sober and miserable. Yeah. Watching it all unfold.
That's Sinead's take.
It's got to be rough.
Which I really appreciate. Here's the thing, too, and this is one of those shows that, like we say in the industry, like very inside Hollywood.
Yeah.
Right? A show like Episodes, if you will, on Showtime.
Oh, but Episodes is so funny.
Episodes is super funny, and you can get behind it. Here's the thing with stand-up comedians, and a lot of, like Andrew Santino is one of the stars of the show. He's a very good buddy of mine. Awesome, awesome stand-up comedian. An absolute madman. Any of the stuff you can see online of him, he's been on Tremos. A lot of comedians back then and to this day are all depressed megalomaniacs.
Yeah.
And a lot of that is like, okay, great. You know, do I really want to see that in a show with the same people? Like the same depressed person over and over again, just a different hairstyle and a different beard. Do you know what I mean by
that?
Like, I don't know if that appeals to me. I thought with vinyl, what we were going to get is like the inner workings of the rock industry, and like this is going to be cool instead of some crazy cokehead, fake cokehead that was like kind of a madman that was really just like
trying to do a murder cover up. Show, I can't even.
I mean, come on,
Griff.
It just washes over me. You know, I just heard all the vinyl hate for so long. It just goes. I mean, it just washes over me. I'm fine. I'm comfortable with my love for vinyl. If you haven't seen vinyl, go watch it. It was
one of the
most underrated shows of 2016, in my opinion. Now, this comedy show, I don't really know the inner workings of the comedy world. I don't know much about comedic history. So for me, this looks kind of interesting. Not like I'm like, whoa, I can't wait till this comes out. But I'm like, I'll check out a couple episodes. I know nothing about the world that you two are talking about. So except for like Chris Rock and a couple of the big names.
Right.
Outside of them, I don't really know. So I'd check it out just for history's sake.
Sure.
But even Chris Rock didn't do a show about stand-up comedy. He did a show about his childhood.
Yeah. Everybody.
And top five, though. That's a great movie.
What's that?
Everybody hates
Chris. Sorry.
Yeah, see, that's,
Yeah, but that was a fun show. I really liked that show. Mm-hmm. And then that kid got freaking smoked on Walking Dead. I felt bad for him. He's such a fun character.
Oh, that was him?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
No. Yeah.
Okay, we got some actual TV to talk about, which I'm really excited about. We've been talking about this for a long time. David and I are finally together. We are synergizing. We are on the same episode. And
finally.
Have just completed the most recent episode of Vikings.
I can sleep now. Sasha, just look at those photos. Sasha would be good in Vikings. Look at those ladies back there.
Thank you so much.
Just get a little dress and a little get your hair in braids.
I dig those braids. Yeah. I would rock those. Mm-hmm. Hell yeah.
Here's three things that's why Sasha would be good in Vikings. One, she's got the perfect blonde hair for it.
Oh, she does, yeah.
Two, she's a crazy badass.
That's so true.
It's true, very true.
And three, she doesn't take shit from anybody.
Yeah.
She's
be great for Vikings. She's a shield maiden. Yeah. If you want to lag at the shield maidens.
Oh, no, you're going to make me want to watch the show so I can imagine myself.
Yes. Binge it. It's one of the greatest.
Okay.
It's Game of Thrones in real life. This is real history. This is real Viking history. These are real people. And the guy that writes it, produces it.
Michael Hurst. Yeah.
Michael Hurst.
Was a Viking.
No, he is read, is so well versed in Viking knowledge. The guy is a Viking encyclopedia. He writes every episode.
Yeah, he doesn't have any writing partners. It's all him.
It's all him.
Whoa.
And he wrote, I don't know if you liked the show, but he also wrote Tudors as well. It's not as soapy as Tudors.
Yeah.
But
it's
still.
Are
there as many butts?
No, not as many.
It's on history.
But there's a lot of good looking men. All right. You need to see with beards.
All right.
A lot of abs and beards.
A lot of abs and beards.
You're
I am so. Oh, well, then we have to like. Spoiler warning.
We got to throw a spoiler warning
up.
We're going to have to spoil some stuff. So if you aren't caught up in Vikings.
Yeah.
And I know there's a lot of people out there that aren't. And I'm buying time until the spoiler alert shows
it's
up.
There.
It's
new.
New one.
Oh, it's like slick. Oh, look at that.
Whoa. It's very, very subtle.
It's subtle, not only subtle, but it looks like the old like the timer font. Like
it looks
five,
like my microwave.
Four.
Oh, yes. I was gonna say
it looks like
my old.
You know,
we're
gonna get somebody saying like it's not big enough. I didn't see it. So the spoiler warning is up. Even if that looks really nice. I like that.
What's the beeper for I love you? What was it?
It was 1-4-3.
Yeah, 1-4-3. All right, that's Kirby Rob's. Go ahead.
So we need to talk about Michael Hurst and you know history, and of course the actors deciding they went through this. They took out their main star.
They did this season.
I mean, granted, it's
not even in the season finale.
Right.
Or a mid-season.
Oh, sorry,
finale.
Sasha.
No, it's okay. I realize what I'm doing.
So Travis Fimmel has come a long way. You know, for those of you who have maybe saw the Warcraft movie, you know, he's that was his big thing. Not the best debut ever for him, but he's a great actor and he's really grown. He's a Calvin Klein model, former Calvin Klein model. Who's kind of what happened?
Like when Ragnar.
Oh, Ragnar. Yeah, his expressions.
When he's on heroin with the Asian girl at the end of the mid-season finale, just.
And he's just been so good. It's just a shame that they had to. They stuck to the history as best they could. And they had to tell that story. That was his end of his story. But he's the face of the show, and he's gone.
One of the more brutal ways to go, too.
Oh, it was an awful
snake pit getting bitten.
So well done.
So I guess leading up until now, the reason that I love this show is it really, like I said, it's Game of Thrones in real life. Women and men are just as strong and as badass as one another. And I really can't wait. Like this episode, I cannot wait to see what Ivar the Boneless does.
He's good. I love the kids. I love all the sons of Ragnar, Caswell. Ever since they made that jump, I think it was season two, when they got older Bjorn.
Older Bjorn.
Alexander
Skarsgård.
No, Bjorn is his name's different. But he was in the Hunger Games movies when he was younger. He's in the first Hunger Games movie.
Yeah.
It's just they've done such a good job casting. These guys look so cool with the beards. They look very Scandinavian, you know.
Gustav Skarsgård.
Yeah, well that's Floki. I'm talking about Bjorn, older Bjorn. Gustav Skarsgård
is
Floki.
Okay.
But the cast is just incredible. The locations, the way they shoot it. They don't have as big of a budget as
Alexander
Game of Thrones.
Ludwig.
Alexander Ludwig. Yeah. But you can see where the money is going, and they do a good job with what they have. The sets, the costumes, and they just own it. The people
boats,
just own it. The boats are gorgeous.
It really is an unbelievably cinematic show.
Yeah.
And I think it has the most balls of most shows because it's like Game of Thrones. They kill everybody. And they're not dragging it out for historical purposes. That's ridiculous.
No, it's gorgeous. We're going to get a whole another 20-episode season after this. There's 3 episodes left this season. We're almost to the finish line. Oh, yeah, he's got to go because he's going to be in the new show called Taken. I think what he's going to do is he's going to show up. I know,
his
looks
Aaron,
bad.
His
Taken
Aaron
looks bad.
Taken
if you want to see Rolo with a Christmas sweater on, watch the Taken trailer. It's coming on NBC
looks like
in February.
Gave him a toupee.
So I think what's going to happen is Rolo is going to help he's going to go avenge his brother. He's going to show up. He's going to come with his own crew, his own Frenchmen probably, and then he's going to get killed in battle. He's going to get killed in battle because he's got to go do Taken on NBC.
I think Floki's going to have to take him down.
I hope he's just slain. I don't want to see him slain by one of his friends. I hope he's just killed.
Okay.
Yeah. In battle.
But yeah, Vikings, man. I know a lot of you have been asking us to talk about it. So we'll talk about every episode going home for sure. Because we only have 3 left in this season.
I'm so glad you're caught up. I can sleep well. God, I was like, Josh is not caught up. And a lot of people were tweeting like, hey, Josh and David, what do you think about blah, 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 blah?
As soon as I saw Vikings in a tweet, I looked
up. And I was like, don't look.
And I will say, when we lost the good man in the snake pit, I cried a little bit. I shed some Viking tears. I probably shouldn't admit that to the gods.
You cry for every show,
I
though.
Do cry a lot.
That's all right. Mm-hmm. We appreciate your sensitivity.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Let's cut on to Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Now, I thought my lovely co-host over here.
I'm sorry. Honestly, the only way I keep track of television is by what shows up on my DVR.
Oh, no.
So someone in the DeFreeze household is getting slapped because it didn't show up.
Kelly.co didn't record it?
No, she does not watch Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
God, Kelly.
But I don't know what happened. I don't know if it got kicked off or what, because I usually just check every morning on my DVR to see what I missed from the night before.
Yeah.
And I, for some reason, didn't even think about it this morning.
Okay, so real quickly, I will say this. they are going the route of a Westworld, in a sense, right? Where now they're dealing with certain AIs and all this kind of stuff. There was a really good twist at the end, which I dug with the whole AI storyline that they're going with. I love the Inhuman that is played, the senator and her brother, who, spoiler alert, I won't tell you what happens, but I love this actor. He was in Halt and Catch Fire. I really enjoy this storyline. I think what they're doing and what was really fun and what has always been my problem with Westworld and with AI is that Simmons and I think her name is JoJo, the girl that is the Flash, basically.
Yo-Yo.
They are making fun of, like, everybody knows you shouldn't create AI. They're just robots, and eventually they'll get smart, and they'll kill everybody. And I'm like, duh, that's why you should have melted Westworld from the top down. Like, as soon as they started getting smart, should have killed them all. And that's what they're trying to do in this. And thank God there was this really fun twist in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. High-quality episode, good start to second half of season two.
How does it feel without Ghost Rider?
A little missing.
Yeah.
It's a little missing. Although that storyline did wrap up, you're still dealing with some of the Darkhold stuff, and I think he'll come back. But it's not like we're missing him. It's just there is a void. You can feel a void. But this was a beginning of the second half.
At least they wrapped it up nicely in a way that I was like, all right with.
Yeah. Amanda watches Blindspot, and the guy that played Lincoln in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is in Blindspot. And every time he comes up, she's like, I know, he was in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I was like, yeah, I mean.
Did you watch Slingshot?
I didn't. Did you?
No.
Okay.
Maybe we should.
For next time?
Yeah.
Okay. Slingshot coming at you guys. All right. We have two more pilot reviews and then straight to Twitter questions. The one we've been talking about ad nauseum here on TV Talk. Taboo. Oh, no. I don't like Sasha's face.
Why? Ew. That's mean.
Did you? No, I thought I look like those negative about to take a huge dump on Taboo. Is that not the face?
What? I was literally just listening to you, but apparently that is my face.
Oh, no, that was mean. Sasha's face is so S.H.I.E.L.D. maiden worthy. There you go. You're back. No, we've been talking about Taboo forever. It's finally out. I know a lot of our British fans, people across the pond, have already seen it. But for us, this is our first chance of watching it here on American television. I got to say, when it first started, I had to rewind it like four or five times because it was so hard to understand what they were saying because it was such a thick English brogue and it was so low. Like, Tom Hardy's such a low speaker and so was a couple of other characters. But once I got into it, I flipped out.
Tom Hardy has perfected the art of grunting.
Yes.
It started in Mad Max. He's like,
He's got the brood.
Yeah, he's just in a room. He's looking around. He's like,
it started in Mad Max. It started in Bronson.
Like, obviously, spoiler alert, because we're going to be reviewing the whole pilot. Like, oh, there's the big one. Look at
there
that.
There you go.
That's that one.
What happened to the mini one?
I love how, like, you know, when they're doing the funeral. I guess it's the ceremony after the funeral, and people in the bar, and there's always like, just looks nasty. Like, the way they capture London, it just looks gross.
Because
if you went back in that time, it would be nasty.
Gross.
Like, I love my Pride and Prejudice. I love my Downton Abbey, but everything's just so clean and neat and pretty. I'm like, no, it wouldn't really look like
they
that.
They have white teeth in all those shows.
Yeah,
nobody.
I love how gritty and just dirty it is. And I love when he's just like, you know, just surveying everything, looking around. He's like, it's got a grunts
bar,
and leaves.
When they're like just slopping up like animal parts in that alley.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Peas
in the trough.
It's just so nasty. I mean, I love Stephen Knight as a writer. For those of you who don't know, Stephen Knight writes Peaky Blinders. He wrote the new movie Allied with Brad Pitt, Marion Cotillard. He's a very talented writer. This is a show that takes its time. It is deliberately paced.
Yes.
Some would call it slow. I didn't find it slow. I was into it the whole time. I don't know what's all going on. I have no idea what's happening. There's a lot of weird things happening, visions and nightmares and strange-looking creatures in the river. Like, you know, I don't know what's going on, what happened to him in Africa, but I want to know what happened to him in Africa. I want to know.
I did not find it deliberately paced. I actually thought the pacing was, it moved, like, you got a lot of information pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. And, like, what I love is when you have, like, a moment of real character revelation. And there is a moment where Tom Hardy's character goes back to a family property. And there's some squatters. And the way he handles those people, I was like, oh, girl. This show, the cinematography.
Awesome.
Perhaps unparalleled by anything, with the exception of maybe Game of Thrones.
The shore setting.
Oh, my God.
Because you can tell, like, the boats, they got some CG going there, but it looks like it just blends in perfectly.
Oh, unbelievable.
It is unbelievable. The acting is, Tom Hardy is off the charts.
You know who I loved was the butler.
The butler was great.
God, that was amazing.
The only person who I'm still a little bit hesitant about.
Sister?
Yeah.
Una.
Game of Thrones.
Yeah, Una.
The woman. But I will say, I think a little bit, it's like I'm still holding some grudges about the Red Wedding. And I'm like, if you could have just not been, why couldn't you be the mistress? If you could have just been the mistress and Rob could have married the other person, then everything would have been fine. None of this would have happened. So I don't really know how much of that is me bringing
in an alternative timeline where,
right. Then maybe things would have been better. Arya could have had her brothers. But I think this show is much like Sinead.
Yes.
It's a teen.
What do you think, Sinead?
I mean, I liked it. Out of the two, which we'll get to the Young Pope, I definitely favored the Young Pope.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
But I don't know, like, I will definitely keep watching Taboo. I just don't know if I would be that much in love with it if it wasn't for Tom Hardy. Like, if I'm being 100%
but
honest.
But that's honestly, imagine Mad Men without Jon Hamm. Imagine Breaking Bad without Bryan Cranston.
Yeah.
It's about the casting a lot of the time, and this show is so on his shoulders, and that's what I think makes it so great, because the way he carries it is exquisite.
Yeah.
He's dynamic without doing anything.
Damn.
Yeah.
He is like a static dynamics.
And just this, the casting, not even the leads, except for Jonathan Pryce, who of course is from Game of Thrones.
There's a lot of Game of Thrones people in the show.
But just the scene of the East India Company, all those guys look like snobby old, like before they even say a single word, they look like all snobby old British men. Like it's just, the casting's perfect.
Did you ever see that animated movie, Box Trolls?
Yeah, Box Trolls.
Yeah,
the long face
with the big high
hat
and the cheese.
And they all have a couple like moles on their faces.
Oh,
like,
that
look like.
Do you hate that movie?
I hate that
movie.
Why? Too many turkeys?
Too many turkeys.
No, I don't know. There's something about it.
You're right. The casting of all the ancillary characters is unbelievable. The hookers that came into the wake, everybody. It's just.
They look rough. Like, everybody just looks bad.
The pockmarked skin, like the moles. It's just.
What is the guy? Because the lawyer says, smallpox got me to the verge. To the bone.
Yeah.
When you go to, because there's certain things in your childhood that stick in your brain forever. I remember going to Mount Vernon, which is George Washington's house, right? It's like a school field trip or something. And they told you about these things called Tussie Mussies. Do you guys remember what these, And these, they would hold them, and they were basically like a handkerchief full of flower petals so that they could smell them when they were around each other, because they wouldn't shower for months at a time. And they were just dirty, dirty people, because once they got all done up in their clothes and their hair and everything was done, they never wanted to change it, so they just didn't wash. And they all smelled so bad that they would hold these Tussie Mussies over, and when they would talk to each other and then talk and then put it back so they could smell something nice, because they all smelled so bad. Okay. At that point in life, like, wouldn't you say maybe what we're doing isn't the best thing for our body? But this is what that show kind of totally encapsulates, is just it is just gross.
And I love Tom Hardy's costume, because everybody, there's two different styles. You have the poor people who dress, they look poor, and you have the gentlemen who have their suits on. He's kind of in between. Mm-hmm. You know, his coat is thick, it's warm, it's got to cost him money, it's more expensive than what most people have. He has this big top hat, and he has this nice vest, but he looks kind of like he doesn't care what he's wearing, though. But you could tell he's a man of, you know, means.
Yeah.
I just love that. I just want to know more about what's going on. Like, when he was in the, they were looking at his father's insides to see if he was poisoned or not.
That
and the slave
awesome.
Came out, you know, and he's like, "You can't haunt me right now." He's like, "I have things to do tonight. Don't haunt me right now. Leave me alone." Like, what's all that all about?
And Stephen Knight said in the interview about Peaky Blinders that he's hoping that Taboo will go three seasons and that we finally get to see certain things, but he doesn't know. Obviously, Tom Hardy's schedule is crazy. But Tom Hardy and Stephen Knight are, you know, they're each other's muses. They're like Tony Scott and Denzel Washington back in like 90s, early 2000s, or Scorsese and Leonardo DiCaprio kind of a thing. So I first of all, am so excited to see what this show brings. And two, for more seasons, and see honestly what Tom Hardy does more in the TV space, because this being like the first kind of venture of producing, writing, starring kind of a
thing. So incredible.
Awesome.
The nice thing is too, for our UK people out there, the break's not as bad. It airs for us on FX on Tuesdays. They get it before us on Saturday. So it's the break. So they're on the same episode as we are right now. Yeah,
okay,
it's not too
bad. Okay, final review before we go to Twitter questions. We got the Young Pope. Let's start with Sinead, because she seemed to favor this over Taboo. What'd you think? You said something to me really cool before we started.
Yeah, it was like I looked at the minute marker, and I think I was at like 5:56, or maybe it was just around the 6-minute mark, and my mouth was open, and I like giggled to myself. But the way this show starts is so ridiculous, and it hooks you. Seconds in. I mean, like, literally seconds in. Because the way it, just the opening, I can't even put into words, like, how incredibly shot I thought this pilot was.
Yes.
Like, even if I had zero interest in the story, just the way it looks is so gorgeous that you can't take your eyes off the screen. No. It's like one of the few times, like, I'm a very distracted person, yeah. where it's like when I watch things, it's like the baby's crying, this and everything's happening all around me, or my phone dings. And when I was watching The Young Pope, I was like, everyone, SCF you. Yeah. I literally could not stop watching.
It is one of those shows you have to pay attention to.
You have to pay attention to. Yeah. But I mean, Taboo's kind of like that too.
Yeah, and, oh, for sure.
But I just thought it was so great. I love it. I can't even explain how much more I think of Jude Law too. Yeah. Like,
again,
all of a sudden,
like what you said, I don't know if I'd like Taboo if it was much as Tom Hardy. Like, I don't know if I would love yeah. Young Pope pilot if it wasn't for Jude Law. Like, thinking of other people you would put in this role, because he is so diabolical but so friggin' charming.
So yes. charming. And that's like my favorite type of person. That's yeah. why I fell in love with The Path so much, because it's so interesting to me when you have a character that has so many layers and is mm-hmm. so like complex, and he plays both sides perfectly. Like, you believe and you see what truly is, and I'm so excited for this.
Yeah. You know what you should watch? So, same director, his name's Pablo Sorrentino, right?
Yeah, Paolo Sorrentino.
Paolo. Youth, his movie that came out last year.
It's gorgeous,
is just,
I love that.
There, the visuals, but also the acting is just phenomenal. Jude Law. I feel like this is what Jude Law does. Jude Law comes out, knocks our socks off, and then goes away, and we
yeah.
kind of forget, and we
yeah.
get...
You might do, like, a silly, like, rom-com every now and
yeah.
then. Some,
the
know.
Holiday?
And then Whoa. He shows back
Whoa.
Up.
Whoa! The Holiday's incredible!
I love The Holiday! You know okay. that! We have that in common! I love The Holiday!
But also Diane Keaton. But the thing
She's
for me...
Great.
Is I grew up in a home where everything was available. If I wanted to, like, do drugs or have sex, it was all available. Like, the first time I wanted to do acid, my dad was like, let me get it for you so it's clean. So I never could rebel that way. Like, have I tried drugs? Probably all of them, most of them, not the ones you shoot up. But, like, it didn't matter. Did I have sex? Not until I was 22, because it was so available that I was like, I'm gonna wait until I find somebody I really like. The only thing that was forced on me was religion. Like, I had to have a bat mitzvah.
This is in your underground bunker that you were raised in
by the babysitter. Is a misnomer. You're not
You're
actually
Jewish?
Physically underground. Yeah, girl, I had a nose job. This was up.
I had no idea you were Jewish.
Well, because I'm not. I am not religious, and it is the one thing that I have, like, a visceral reaction to. My parents do Shabbat every Friday night. I will sometimes do the prayers with them. I will celebrate Yom Kippur, because I feel like if I don't, I might get smited and, you know, I'll die that year. But I have
That's
a really,
funny.
Really intense reaction to religious stuff. I don't like it. I don't like being involved in it. I tend to shun it because that's my only way to rebel. So I was worried going into the show. Man.
Yeah.
Whew. Nothing to worry about.
No.
Yeah, it's good.
I feel like even people who have a reaction to it, or who don't have a visceral reaction to religion, can also kind of sense, like, this discomfort with it.
But it's interesting, because I do think that they sort of speak to both sides, the believer mm-hmm. and the non-believer. I would actually love to hear David's opinion on that.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know we were going this deep today. This yeah. is pressure. I went to, for those of you who know, I went to seminary.
Yeah.
I got my master's in theology. I was going to be a pastor at one time. But
can I
got
interrupt you
industry.
Real quick?
Yes.
You have the most, I was at David's house for game night last week. You have the most books of anybody I've ever seen before in his home.
Grad school, anybody who's been to grad school knows you yeah. have to read a lot. Yeah,
a
you can't,
lot of
can't
them,
fake your way.
I'm
Cliff
like pulling
noted.
Thumb aside. I was like, I never knew this was a thing. Like religions and texts mm-hmm. and things that you had to read in the cemetery. Very impressive.
Yeah.
Seminary. Some people do call it cemetery, though. Some people do call it cemetery.
Total Freudian slip. Mabad on that one.
So anything having to do with, even though this isn't church history, because it's modern day, it's like, what if there was an American Pope? Just the, I don't call it ramifications, but just the, what the world would yeah. be like if we had an American, a young, good-looking American Pope.
Gotta
would be
get that
insane.
Pope deep.
Yeah, I mean, it's Jude Law. And when I first saw the trailers for it, I was like, can they get, like, an American actor to play an American? But I love Jude Law, who obviously was not raised in the United States, is doing his best interpretation of what an American Pope would be like. And I think that might be more interesting to watch than actually getting an American to do that role. So I'm glad Jude Law's behind it.
And I think in this role, you could get a little caricature-y in a sense. But he teeters that line, I think, perfectly, mm-hmm. where he could go over the edge and be like, you know, I'm just going to be an eight. And
mustache twirling. It yeah. could be very mustache
Correct.
Twirling.
Correct.
Wrong
and he doesn't.
Hands.
I think for me, you know, I was lucky enough to live in Rome, and I lived actually right behind Vatican City, like on the border of it. And I would walk through St. Peter's Square almost every day. And, you know, I was born and raised very, very Catholic, and I'm somewhere where you are. I'm not, like, super religious, but I also respect the faith, and I respect my parents' wishes and what they still believe in and all that kind of stuff. And for me, to have been in Rome and to see John Paul II and all the things, all the, you know, in being in St. Peter's Square on Easter Sunday and seeing 150,000 people just to see this man do Mass and the pilgrimages these people make, it is really something to behold. Right. And so for something like this, it really gets you to thinking, you know, what if, and that's what I love so much about the show is, because the Catholic Church is so antiquated in certain respects and in its beliefs and in a lot of things, bringing new blood into the church, and that's why that opening monologue is so friggin' funny, yeah. Because I'm like, holy cow, he's going for it. This is super funny.
As soon as I was like, what?
The opening is so great.
That's like he's crawling out of this the pile of babies.
Oh, yes.
God. That's just like,
I know.
Yeah,
it's brilliant. But also, I feel like if we didn't have Pope Francis right now, the show would be a lot harder to watch. But like when Pope Francis is, you know, giving Mass and people saying breastfeed, free the nipple. It's like a lot easier to stomach this show. But this show, God, I'm very excited to see where it goes. And again, this is a situation where it's not just Jude Law. Every single supporting character feels whole, feels fully realized, even though we're only meeting them for maybe a few minutes of screen time. Like when he goes to do confession, that like one little moment of interaction is so rich and dense. There's so much in it. I'm getting the chills just thinking about it.
I love his right-hand man that he's kind of adopted. Like, you know, you need to like do what I be my eyes and ears. I like that guy.
Oh, he's
great. Because you can see he's a little scared. He's like, I don't really want to do this. Yeah. But, you
know. He said nothing my thing.
Yeah.
And also the set design, the production design.
Because you know they didn't have access to the Vatican.
Right.
Vatican's not going to let them go anywhere near that. Ooh. So the set design and all that stuff. I was really lucky to get like a personal tour of some stuff in the Vatican. So what summed up the show for me was when he was looking for an office, right? And he comes out and everybody's in the Sistine Chapel and he closes it. And he's like, and you see a spectacle, and he closes it and you realize that he hates people.
Yeah.
Like he legitimately hates tourists because they're just passing through. And any Catholic knows that, you know, the reason that you're in the religion is to be totally secular and to be in church and to be that religion. And that's what the young Pope wants. Because at the end of the day, yes, he wants to change some things or at least in that thing. But he also is extremely dedicated to the church.
Interesting, because I took that as he's a total misanthrope. And that's why.
Really?
Yeah, that's how I saw it.
Okay.
Okay. But I still think it's fair. So what are we going to do? Are we going to like base this on how many Hail Marys? Like, how do we rate this bad boy?
Oh, man.
Yeah, I think that would be our. How about out of, because we didn't rate Taboo,
out
but
of,
I'm gonna
out of Pope papal hats.
Papal hats.
That hat was nice. That
out
white
hat.
Out of five guys holding a microphone.
out of five incense swingers.
Incense swingers. I'm giving both Taboo and Young Pope a solid 4.85. Trending to 4.9.
Sinead loves the 4.85.
And for Sinead, I will give them both fives. Okay. Because I'm rounding up, girly.
Thank you.
I mean, as far as pilots go, these are both strong, so I'm going to give it five on each,
Now, I promised we would
What about
get...
Sinead?
Oh, Sinead. We just said you gave Sinead.
No, I said in honor of Sinead.
Well, Young Pope gets a five, and just because I had to rewind... I see your four, and I must have rewinded at least 8 or 9 times in Taboo before I understood what the hell I was watching. I'll give Taboo a 4.
Okay.
But enough to keep watching. It's just, you guys know, like I said, very distracted human being. I'm going to give it another watch, too, because it deserves it. But, I love, I know it makes me sound so shallow, but I love simple television. Like, I love television that I just get, and that honestly, minimizes my viewings
your
of TV.
Attention span,
Yes, and it's not good because I'm missing out on so much great television. I know. But so I'll watch it again. But for now, 4 and 5.
Sinead, the best. I will say, this is one of my favorite shows we've ever done.
Oh.
Conversation's just been spot on. I love
Yay.
It. Now, I promise you guys we're going to get to a crap ton of Twitter questions, so that's what we're going to do. This episode will go a little long. So, I mean, a lot of you guys are on holiday, so what the hell? Enjoy it.
Enjoy
the
length.
So let's go to some tweets. Sinead DeFreets.
At 21, I saw what you did there. Yeah. Very clever. At 21, Puck says, what's your favorite show that isn't American or British? And Makuga, we already know you love Orphan Black. Can I start?
That's Canadian, right?
Well, so that's my question. Are we calling Canada part of North America and therefore out of the
conversation? American, I think
like America.
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 Okay.
So you guys all know what mine is.
Degrassi.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Degrassi. Yeah, I feel like there
and
is
maybe,
no real conversation.
And maybe now could become backstage. Just kidding, but I did watch 3 hours of it yesterday.
Oh my God, stop doing it!
My mom walks in and she's like, Sinead. And I'm sitting, I got Harrison on one arm, he's sleeping, and I'm literally watching. I got my Coors, or not my Coors, my Corona in the other hand. And she's like, are you honestly watching this horrible show again? Oh, I was like, Mom, no. It's backstage.
Listen,
you don't understand.
Sinead's living her best life.
I'm just envisioning Corona,
baby backstage.
Corona, backstage. Like, that just don't
mix up the bottles. That is a model mother, if you've ever seen one.
Yeah,
right?
You're crushing. D. Griff.
This that isn't British, like, eliminates 80% of my viewing, yeah. But I'm going to go to the Japan. And definitely One Punch Man. Attack on Titan. Those are some of my favorite.
Those are animated. Right?
Animated, yeah. Those are some of my favorite shows.
I'm going to go one of my favorite shows ever, Trailer Park Boys. It's Canadian as well.
Yeah.
One of the funnier shows. It's very, the first couple seasons, I was like, what the hell am I watching? This is so silly. And then I just got addicted, and me and my buddies dressed as them 1 year for Halloween. It's super fun. Trailer Park Boys.
So if we're keeping Canada in the conversation, I would say Kids in the Hall.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But outside of English-speaking countries, there was a terrible remake of the show on ABC that I think still exists called The Returned. But the French version of the show is unbelievable.
Really?
It's about this small village.
What's it called in French?
The Returned.
Oh, yeah, that show's great, yeah.
Called The Returned in French.
Well, it's like Le Reveillon.
Yeah, Le Reveillon.
Yeah.
But basically, it's about the small village and people that have been dead come back, and it's what happens, and it is so incredibly well done. It just was
There's an American version of it?
Yeah, it was on ABC. It did not last very
long. No, A&E actually made a closer version of it. With Michelle Forbes was in it. A&E did one too.
Oh, that's a bummer. Well, don't watch either of those. Watch the French one.
Because ABC was
really
resurrected,
good.
I think.
Oh,
and then
yes!
The Returned was on A&E. And it was with Michelle Forbes from True Blood and Battlestar Galactica.
Whatever.
Another show too, French, is the show called Marseille.
I love Marseille.
Gerard Depardieu is in it. And it's kind of a gangster, city
there's
drama.
There's some really good Australian stuff out there.
Oh, Glitch. I haven't watched Glitch yet. I haven't seen it.
Do you know there's some really good Australian and New Zealand
Top of the Lake?
Show? Yeah, Top of the Lake.
I don't know who produced that, though. Was that BBC who produced? I don't know if
Top of the Lake was New Zealand TV.
Do you guys remember that show, Jimé?
Yeah.
That shit was the bomb.
Yeah, that's Australian.
Australian.
There was Jimé, but what was the show? It was like High School High.
High School High.
High School High.
Wow.
So
my, have you seen that?
No.
Oh my God.
Okay, it's like Australia. It's an Australian. It's a guy pretending to be a girl. And his parents are South African.
No, he plays five different roles.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. His parents are South African, which immediately got my whole family hooked on it. It is. So HBO, right?
Yeah, HBO, but
watch
it started
watching
it. Yeah.
So you will laugh your ass. I will totally find
it's incredible.
Promise.
Oh, you'll love it.
I know that guy.
Yeah.
I know you're talking about.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Sasha, watch it.
Okay.
Sinead, what's next?
All right. Curious George says, which SNL actor or actress had the best TV career post-SNL?
You know, it's kind of funny. I would say that most of the women on SNL have amazing TV careers after. Men, not so much. I would say, obviously, Tina Fey, Amy Poehler, and Maya Rudolph crushes it on television.
Yeah, I would say Julia Louis-Dreyfus
has
had the best.
Oh, wow.
She had such
arguably
a short stint on SNL.
Yeah, that people sometimes forget. Yeah. I mean, there have been people, obviously, if you talk about, Eddie Murphy, but then you also
more
have to factor
movies,
in.
Yeah.
But I think, Amy Poehler, Tina Fey, but for me, it's Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
Yeah. Mm. I would agree with that.
Yeah. I don't really watch SNL, so that's not my strong suit. Yeah.
Okay, Shane, what's next?
Oliver Queen says, can game shows work during primetime? Many of them that attempt to run get canceled soon after release.
Well, I mean, everybody knows I'm a huge game show fan. My dream job is to be the next Alex Trebek. So I would say yes, but they have to make a spectacle, like this wall show I was trying to watch. It was a little, and I really like Deal or No Deal, but it's so simple. They can only run for a certain amount before people just get really tired of them. Like, who wants to be a millionaire? When that came on, my mom lit her house on fire. She was so excited. This is the greatest show ever. And then 2 weeks later, we're like, all right, we get it. It's Jeopardy with just more money.
It's still good, though.
It's still good. It's always
entertaining. Did you guys watch The Fan or Big Fan after Bachelor?
That was the hands down most embarrassing show I've ever watched for those celebrities. And it was Matthew friggin' McConaughey.
Yep.
And you're surprised the guy who does the Chrysler commercials would show
Lincoln
up.
Well, and then Aaron Rodgers. Kardashian has an episode coming out.
Yeah. You're surprised Kim Kardashian
Kristen
has
Kristen Bell.
Episode.
Like these are like A-list celebrities.
Yeah, these are big celebrities, and people are like.
And these weird, like these psycho fans are like, I stole your tooth at a game. And you're like,
ew,
what? That was
it is. My sister was like, we literally said shame so many times because the contestants made us feel that uncomfortable.
Shame.
It's hard. I think game shows in primetime, like the Match Game with Alec Baldwin, a lot of these new primetime ones, they're doing okay and they'll have their like times, but they're always going to be flash in the pan.
Yeah, but like one of my favorite game shows ever is Family Feud. God, I just wish I had a fan.
So
we
good.
Should go on as our TV Talk family because I crush.
Yes.
But when they did the primetime one that was an hour long, it was terrible. But I would contend shows like Survivor and The Amazing Race and The Bachelor are game shows in their own way. Or like if you watch
Top Chef.
Like Top Chef is a game show, essentially, just with more narrative
structure.
Food's
big now.
Yeah.
We have all the MasterChef, you know,
that's
his
a game
empire.
Show?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right,
it's true.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
Did I skip one? Cam? Is Cam
next?
Yeah,
Cam's next.
Cam says, what are the most unforgettable moments in TV history for you guys?
It's such a broad question. I would relegate it. I mean, I think there are moments for me that just stick out in certain shows. They may not be my favorite shows, but they are just so unforgettable that I always quote them or I always think about them in certain. Obviously, there's a ton of Seinfeld references, but there was the episode of Family Ties when Tom Hanks was the alcoholic uncle and he was drinking vanilla. And when I was a kid, I was making pancakes. I was like, Mom, if I drink this, will I get drunk like the uncle? And then she's like, don't drink the vanilla, stupid. And I'm like, okay. There was like the scene in 90210 when Brian Austin Green had to flush all his drugs down the toilet and Brandon was the one that kind of saved him from that. I always thought that was like a nice callback to like, you know, friendship in high school and that kind of stuff. Obviously, there's some Sopranos moments like Pine Barrens when they eat the ketchup. Every time I eat a ketchup packet, I think when they were freezing to death and they just had ketchup
packets. I do
packets.
That. I, like whenever like, I have a ketchup packet and I squeeze as much as I can, for some reason, I just have it always go like this and just suck the rest out. I don't know why I do that. It's just
that's,
a habit. Yeah.
That's a Pine
do you realize
thing.
How many hands go in and pick out those ketchup?
Yeah,
oh my God, my OCD just went crazy.
It's gross, but
I'm still here. I'm still here, folks. I'm still here.
Oh yeah.
But the, like certain ones for me, that's it. Like, I mean, spoiler alert, that's the Opie's death in Sons of Anarchy was so tough. A lot of deaths in Sons of Anarchy were really brutal. Obviously, you mentioned it earlier, Red Wedding might have been the most unforgettable moment in Game of Thrones.
I mean, when I think about unforgettable moments, this is horrible, but all of mine went to like real life. Like I thought about when I was in elementary school and they wheeled a TV into our room and we watched the Challenger explode.
I think of
being home, because I graduated high school 2 years early, being home and watching the O.J. verdict by myself and being in Oaklandish, hearing automatic gunfire of people celebrating because they were so excited that he wasn't guilty. Like, those are the things I remember, which is really sad.
Crazy,
way to bring down the room, Sasha. Sorry.
I
third-personed. That's how bad it was.
Oh, man. For me, it's more modern television. I have moments like you, like Seinfeld, Simpsons, where I have quotes that I can just say over and over again. But for me, one of them was Battlestar Galactica. Of course. I won't say who or what. There's a scene where somebody commits suicide unexpectedly in one of the later seasons. I was like it was one of those scenes where I jumped up out of my seat. I don't do that a lot when I watch TV. I jumped out. It freaked me out. Also, Mad Men, when Don Draper asked Megan to marry him, I jumped out of my seat when that happened.
Yeah.
Like, that was one of the crazy things on TV that was one of the most impactful ones on TV I'd ever seen. It was somebody asking someone else to marry them.
Yeah.
It wasn't like a woo drama. It was just like, this is bad.
Really?
This is a bad decision. Like,
so stupid.
Donald Draper ruins everything. Do not marry this man. So yeah, it's just kind of like subtle things like that.
Nasty, something under Degrassi.
No. I have plenty of Degrassi. I mean, obviously, like, I feel like I can relate every situation to a Friends episode. So for me, like, that's probably my least forgettable show because I remember every detail. But now that you're talking about like sad, so sorry to bring it down again.
Yeah,
but one of my first TV memories ever, I was 6 years old. I was still living in South Africa was Princess Diana's death. And she was like huge there as well. People just adored her. And I remember like it happened on a Sunday, I believe. It happened on a Sunday, but like that was running all of that Monday. My mom kept me home from school.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, because my mom was like, I can't leave the house. I'm not taking you to school. Sorry. And I remember like sitting in my school uniform, like on my mom's bed, just like watching the news. So that's honestly, probably my first real memory of like watching television was just watching like the last footage that they had of her car, the car, like driving into the tunnel.
Yeah. It's crazy.
So, yeah. It's nuts.
That's a good point. That's what it does. It's kind of dark, but it does stick with you, those powerful moments like 9/11.
Where you were.
Obviously. Like you, stuff you won't forget. For our parents, it's probably when Kennedy was shot. I mean, they'll never forget that, you know?
Yeah. All right, we have a little bit of time, but I would like to try and get to all of these because I put a bunch of these and you guys sent in so many good ones. So let's try and just speed it up a tad.
Hoodies says, if you could guarantee the renewal of one currently airing show and keep it from cancellation, what would it be?
Pitch! 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 Please! Please! Fox, do not cancel Pitch! It's so great!
I'm with you, Sasha, on that one.
Oh my God.
I am, because I have a sneaking suspicion that we're not going to get more Pitch.
So during the TCAs, they didn't confirm a renewal or a cancellation. They're like, we're still looking at the numbers. Don't look at the numbers. Look at the quality of the show and look at the passion of the fans. I'm like, what do we have to do? Should we send in peanuts? Should we send in Cracker Jacks? What do we do? We need Pitch to stay on the air.
Pitch needs to stay in the air.
They still haven't decided on that?
No, that Scream Queens, and there was another one that they're not sure about.
Yeah. Interesting. But
Pitch is so effing good.
All right, skip me. Go, Dave.
I'd like to see more Black Sails.
Oh, man.
Because it's a prequel to Treasure Island. I want to see them get to Treasure Island. I want to see them actually keep going and just jump ahead and go to Treasure Island, even though I know this is supposed to be the last season. I'd like to see one more season.
Yeah. All right, Sinead?
I mean, I'm honestly kind of okay with TV shows getting canceled.
Okay.
honestly, because if keeping it from cancellation, does he mean just because of one season that's already aired this year?
Yeah, I mean, I would think anything.
Because one of the ones that I really care about, I've already gotten confirmation that they're going to continue. But if we're talking grand scheme of things, one show that you just know is never going to leave the air, I don't like that idea because too much of a good thing is never a good thing, right?
Yeah. Kind of with you on that one. All right, what's next?
All right, Michael says, how do you guys drop shows? I mentally can't drop a show when I've invested so much time in it. Any shows like that for you? What's that one show you watched? Contagion or something?
Oh, God, that was such a...
You watched the whole season of it?
You watched the whole series. The whole season of it.
Sasha assumed I was watching. I'm like, why are you watching that show?
She assumed I was watching it, and none of us were.
Nobody watched that show, and then every week she went, I'm still watching it, and
I
suck.
There were shows that I should have dropped. I should have dropped Californication, because that show was, great, and then
I dropped Californication.
Terrible. I'm so glad that I dropped a show House of Lies, because that show was the same season over and over and over again.
I just dropped Grey's Anatomy, and I'm really proud of myself.
I dropped Grey's Anatomy
in season
5.
I had 10
episodes on my DVR, and I was like, let's be real. You're never watching these, and I just canceled the recording.
Yeah. Honestly,
that's how you do it. You just cancel the recording.
No, here's what you do. You stop watching, and then when they announce a series finale, do what we did with The Good Wife.
Yeah.
So she's a lawyer.
She's a lawyer. Okay, go ahead, Dave.
Walking Dead. I've seen almost every episode up until this most recent season. There I watched the first couple. And
now,
I was
do you feel bad at all that you...
Well, it's just hard because it's the most watched drama on television. So it's you feel compelled from a cultural zeitgeist because that's what everybody's into.
Do you watch Big Bang Theory?
No.
So there you go.
Yeah. But the thing is, I like the Walking Dead universe. I play the video games, I read the comics, but that's another story.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
Lou Bloom says...
Wait, spoiler alert. Oh, good. Good call. Nice.
Oh, wow.
What's the best violence scene on TV? My favorites are Opie and Tara's death on Sons of Anarchy.
Easy one for me. There's nothing even close. The Blood Eagle season 2 of Vikings. Blood Eagle, you kill a guy, you take an axe and you rip open the back of his body, you take out all of his organs, and if he screams, he will not make it in to meet the gods at Odin's table.
That's hot.
You pull his rib cage back out
too,
make him like wings,
him the Blood Eagle.
Yeah, it's nasty.
That is
what
crazy.
Gangster. So if he screams,
don't
they all scream? That's ridiculous.
He at the end he does scream, so he doesn't make it with the gods, and then his family is pissed about it.
Well, that's just. I mean, there are so many examples from Game of Thrones. The Red Wedding was brutal. Battle of the Bastards was incredible. In terms of violence, I actually loved the scene where Jax kills Gemma. I love that scene. I thought that was great.
For me, it's going to be the Nick season 2 finale.
Oh God!
He's friggin' operating on—he's cutting his own stomach open, operating on himself, Clive Owen.
That was gnarly.
Insane.
Yeah. And going back to the first episode where they did the failed cesarean section.
Yeah.
Oh, I never have to look away. I had to look away. I had to look away from that scene.
Brutal. All right, Sinead, what's next?
Nate says, in the vein of Arrowverse, who would you want as Bruce Wayne or Batman?
Okay, let's do this all together because I know the person we're going to say.
Ready?
You guys ready?
Yeah.
In 3, 2, 1.
Matt Bomer.
I mean, I knew you guys were going to say that.
Great minds think alike.
See, I like Ballmer for Superman more than Batman.
Okay, well, who are you going to say?
Because of the blue eyes? Those piercing blue eyes.
Well, he looks like Clark Kent. Yeah, it looks like
Clark
Kent.
Yeah, he does. Yeah. But that's what we said. You guys can't pick Matt Ballmer for everything, because when we were casting Super Donk, that's what you said, too. Before we knew that it was Tyler Hoechlin, you both said Matt Ballmer. True. He can't be your answer for everything.
He's so C-dubs, yo.
Yeah,
you know what would be good? Except Travis doesn't have... His hair's not dark, but Travis Fimmel would be a good Bruce Wayne. He's a beast.
Yeah. Okay.
Lou Bloom back again. He says if you could create your own show, who would showrun, direct, and star in it, and which network would produce it?
I would have David Chase showrun it. I would have him also direct in it. And starring as me in the show, obviously, Matt Ballmer.
Oh, they were going to say yourself.
God. So it's a show about Josh McCouga?
It would be on Netflix, yeah.
About the life and adventures of Josh McCouga?
Josh McCouga, the post-college years. From like senior year in college until I was 24 and moved to LA. So like post-college in New York.
Your last name sounds like a show.
McCouga.
And that's all it is. That's the opening of it. And it's just like...
Sinead? Or Sasha?
Lou, stop reading my diary. I can't answer that because that is what I mean, all this whole like hosting stuff, that's my day job. All I want is to show run my own show. Huh? But if I had to sell one of my scripts, please God, my dream would be to do a comedy with David Wayne do a drama with Moira Wally Beckett or to do some hybrid of both with Jenny Kohner and Lena Dunham. And it depends on the script. In terms of who would star in it, but there's one that I would want Rosario Dawson for, there's one I would want Jennifer Garner for, and there's one that I wanted Donald Glover for, but now I gotta go dream another dream.
What about Brian Tyree Henry?
No.
Okay. Oh, yeah, he's good. My showrunner, of course, would be Julian Fellowes, because there's no better showrunner in Hollywood. Julian Fellowes is the showrunner for Downton Abbey, of course. He's just a magnificent man. It would be a show, I would have it would be set in Victorian, London, and I would have it with what's her name, Rosamund Pike from Gone Girl, and she's also in Pride and Prejudice with Karen Knightley. I would have her as the lead, and it would be me in it as well. I would also star in it. It would be up this young African American man he's come over from Africa, so he's African, and it's like this forbidden love because you know white people and black people back then that's not good, and it would be about all that forbidden love, and it'd just be drama. It'd be good.
I would watch the shit out of that show.
And then would at
can
least...
I play your biraracial daughter?
Yes.
You can be Rosamund Pike and David Griffin.
I'm not technically biracial, people might get really upset because you're casting incorrectly, but
that's true.
I could pass.
We could use your son as the baby version, then once you get older, then it's you.
Yeah, but he's white, so that
doesn't sound like
that'd
be really weird. He's a boy, too.
He's a boy.
Okay, Sinead, real quick, and then let's do some we'll do rapid fires, please, whatever.
All right, Matt says, best musical episodes already aired, Love Scrubs, and It's Always Sunny this week.
The Always Sunny one was hysterical because it made fun of musicals. I've never liked a musical episode. That's me.
Ally McBeal had a great one.
Got it.
Simpsons Clip Show.
There you go.
I don't know, but Pretty Little Liars did just announce that they're going to do some songs coming up. So we'll see.
Okay.
Oliver Queen says, I recently binged Lost, and from what I can see online, it's a bit of a love it or hate it show. What's your guys' opinion on it?
Love it.
One of my favorite shows of all time.
Never finished it.
Never seen it.
Got it. Shane.
Jim Fickey says, what is everyone's favorite TV game show? My new favorite is The Wall on NBC.
Jeopardy
with The Bachelor being a close second.
Mm-hmm. Oh, those count.
Does The Bachelor count?
The Price is Right and Top Chef.
There you go. Sinead.
Well, if The Bachelor counts, then The Bachelor. But if we're talking like traditional game shows, it's Family Feud for sure.
Bachelor is drama.
Okay. Rapid fire.
Charlie says, funniest British TV show? For me, it's Only Fools and Horses or Fawlty Towers.
Hands down, Inbetweeners. Funniest show I've seen in the last 5 years.
I'm going Fawlty Towers. I love Fawlty Towers.
Awesome.
I know it was on episodes. Even though I know it was on HBO, it's British.
Yeah.
It's a British comedy. British. Yeah, I love Ricky Gervais.
Sinead.
I have no idea.
No, episodes isn't. You're thinking of extras.
Extras.
Yeah. Extras.
Extras. Episodes is Matt LeBlanc.
Yeah. There you go.
Oh, God. Extras.
Matt says, in honor of La La Land, what show would you like to see do a musical episode?
I'm going to pass.
What show would we like to see on right now?
Oh, yeah, we like. Game of Thrones.
No.
Do a musical?
No.
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 Yes.
I am sorry, Mrs. Griffin.
Yes.
Are you drunk?
No.
Griffin's drunk. He drank the vanilla.
Water in here. This is
he drank
water.
The vanilla. That's what happened.
That's hilarious.
I can't think of any show I would want to see do that, but I can think of one that could have that I would have loved, which is Gossip Girl.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, yeah.
All right. What's next, Sinead?
Jedi DMF says, what TV shows have you guys never seen that most people have? Well, for me, it's obviously Game of Thrones and like pretty much every TV show you guys have seen.
Yeah. David?
I mean, I never finished Lost. Like, oh, no, Buffy. I never got into Buffy.
Yeah, I never got into Buffy either. We have a lot of those. And I also never watched the season of Firefly.
Ooh.
I lied to you guys last week. I tried to start The Crown, and like I pulled up, the trailer was running on Netflix, and I was like, God, this looks so effing boring. And I watched Snowfall Sinead. Instead, but
All right, Sinead.
Nick says, if you had to be the love interest for any of the main characters of the DC TV shows, who would you choose and why? Super Donk, because it's Donk?
Bad butt. Donk. Yeah.
David?
Nyssa Al Ghul.
Well, I know you're
because I love fan. Katrina Law, so yeah, that wouldn't be nice.
Oh man, I got that thing for Emily Bett Ricards. I got a little Felicity.
Like the Felicity?
Yeah.
I love Felicity, but it's all about that Super Donk.
Super Donk.
Donk. That super
back,
donk.
Back. Go ahead.
Tom says, what is your favorite toilet scene in a TV show?
I don't know.
Toilets.
When when Ross and or when Chandler Julia Roberts guest stars in the episode where she's trying to get revenge on Chandler for something that happened when they were back in school. So she steals his underwear, and Chandler is left wearing like a thong. And she's like, put this on for me. I think it'll be hot. So he puts on the thong, and she takes his clothes and runs away. And then Joey comes in the bathroom and discovers him wearing ladies' underwear. And it is hilarious.
Okay.
Oh, Dave. The Simpsons. Is it Bart Simpson versus like the people of like Australia or something like that? Where the toilet he wants to know if the toilet flushes the other way, you know, in the southern hemisphere. So he calls Australia's longest phone call. He has to go to Australia, and then they have to boot him. They boot him. They get a big boot. They wear the boot, and they have to boot him. That's the punishment for his crime. It's awesome.
Isn't totally a toilet scene, but the gay guy on Sopranos, they call him Johnny Cakes or whatever. His son after he gets killed, his son rebels and becomes like this goth, and he poops in the locker room shower in front of kids in high school.
Oh man, I don't like, honestly, this is where my OCD gets really weird. I am very weird about stuff in the bathroom. Good. I actually almost stopped watching Girls because the first episode they eat a cupcake in the bathroom and I was like, oh, the show is disgusting. So this is not the question for me. I abstain.
Let's do three more.
Curious George says, what actors and actresses have multiple good TV shows?
Sarah Paulson, I guess.
Bryan Cranston.
Julie Louis-Dreyfus.
What's the show Tandy Newton's in that everyone else watches?
Westworld.
No, but the other one.
Tandy?
Wasn't she in one just recently, right before Westworld?
Sarah Paulson is a heads-up call. Oh, yeah. Sterling K. Brown.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, this is us. This
Am
week.
I drunk now? Am I making that up in
I
my
think
head?
You might have made that up.
No, interesting.
Yeah. Okay. Two more.
Vanilla. Ryan says, have you ever ran into a person who was in a show that you kind of destroyed in a review and they were aware of it?
It hasn't happened to me yet, but probably will.
It's happened to me with movies, but not with TV shows.
Okay. I've had TV, but it's more for praise. Like, I got to interview the cast of Vikings and people in history. Like, oh, yeah, we read your reviews all the time. It's great. But it's all positive. So
I actually just lied, and I just remembered that has totally happened to me, and it was extremely uncomfortable, and it was a dear friend.
Oh, no. Mm.
That was bad.
Yikes. All right, last one.
Alex says, what TV intro themes are so good that you don't mind watching during a binge?
Well, I will say one that I cannot stand, and I binged both seasons, and I will never, is the theme
don't,
song. To,
don't.
No, the Man in the High Tower.
Oh, okay, good.
Man in the High Tower theme song is
Man
so
Man in the High
creepy.
Castle or
Man
Tower?
Man in the High Castle, sorry. Man in the High Castle's theme song
that
is
Edelweiss
so creepy.
That
Edelweiss Slow? Edelweiss Slow. As Nazi planes come over America, I'm like, no friggin' way. No. But I will say my favorite intro of shows that even if it was part of a binge, I would watch it any time is the Growing Pains theme song.
Aw.
Best theme song current ever of the last like 10 years is Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt.
Oh,
it gets so stuck
in my
See, yeah, that is that's cool. It is off the charts now.
Yeah,
I have to go
so
home
good.
And listen to it.
And I always sing along with it.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
I never get bored of it. I would say when I did used to binge House of Cards, I didn't mind that intro at all.
That
it just
intro.
Got me more in the mood for House Cards.
Yeah.
I love Supernaturals because it scares you. Because like it'll just be like something will happen, it'll cut, and there'll be this explosion, and the logo will come up, and it's always a different scene for every season. I think it's great.
Also, Lost. It wasn't really a theme song. It was just a wham. And
those
I
are the best
it.
Kinds of theme songs.
Yeah, I like that.
All right. Well, we didn't get to two questions.
Come on, let's go.
Danny
Hernandez says, "Gonna show with the concept pushing daisies had."
Can you show what the concept of
Pushing Daisies had bring folks back to life, be successful on a streaming device?
Streaming service.
Yeah. Streaming service.
Of course.
Sorry.
Yeah, sure. Why not?
Totally. I love Pushing Daisies. I'm really sad it didn't get more of a chance.
There we go. Last one.
What do you think the perfect episodes per season and. Wait.
Yes. The episodes per season and season
per series
is. Well, I think we can, I will say, the most perfect episode for me is Pine Barrens and Sopranos, and the most perfect season of Sopranos is season 2. That's my, of my, all my favorite shows.
Ozymandias of Breaking Bad, and it's really hard to pick a best season. And I'll go with season 4 of Sex and the City.
Oh, okay. Not bad.
I will do Spartacus War. Wait, what's the first one? Spartacus Blood and Sand, episode 4, That Thing in the Pit, because that's what transformed the series from being kind of crap to like really good all of a sudden in the first few episodes. Favorite season would be Gods of the Arena, which is sadly when Andy was going through his chemo and everything. But that was such an awesome miniseries they did to, you know, kind of buy him some time.
There you go. Shane. Yeah.
Well, I feel like I shouldn't talk about Friends because I always do. But my favorite episode of television ever is the one where they fight for the apartment. That is my favorite. And if you're going to watch Friends, season six is my favorite. But also Gossip Girl, the first season,
so good.
Is incredible. Like some people, so many people that I knew watched it fell off. You know, after, but all can agree that the first season of Gossip Girl is 100% one of the most binge-worthy shows ever.
But incredible. The fashion gets much better around season 3.
That's true.
Season 4 of The Simpsons is an incredible season of television, too. 4 through 8 just kind of changed the game. Okay, that's it for us on TV Talk, the extended Martin Luther King Jr. Day edition, because we pre-taped it. Thank you all so much for watching and going. And thank you for sending in all those Twitter questions. We love hearing from you guys. So sorry it took so long to get to all those Twitter questions, and it's a long episode. So, you know, sit back, relax, enjoy your Monday, and watch a little TV Talk. Before we go, where can the good people find you, Sinead DeFries?
I'm online at Sinead DeFries and at thatsosinead.com here on Monday's hosting TV Talk, on Fridays hosting Movie Talk, and hosting Mailbag over the weekend.
David Anthony Edward Griffin IV.
Yes, there's no Anthony, and there's no fourth.
What was it, Sir?
Sir David Edward Griffin of Yorkshire.
People corrected me. If I actually was a knight, it would just be Sir David. That's what they say over there. It's very, very, very simple.
Well,
you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at GriffinDE. Be sure, this is Monday, folks. We're already on Monday. It's MLK, so go back a few days. And on Saturday, Christian and Ken and I review the latest episode of Star Wars Rebels.
There you go. Sasha Pearl Raver.
You can find me at Sasha Pearl Raver on Twitter and Instagram, hosting FX Movie Download every Friday on FX, and here with these foolios regularly on Monday, being the Queen of Shade.
Oh, there she is. I'm Josh McCuga at Josh McCuga on Twitter and Instagram, The Josh McCuga Show on YouTube, here every Monday, talking all things TV Talk. As always, hashtag at Clavered TV Talk. Tweet at us. Yell at us. Tell us what you like, what you didn't like. Thanks for watching this extended edition. And as always, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.